probably 6 tips.
I've done that before. Okay, let me re-say that for our listeners elsewhere. We are going to create a list of tips here for working these identities and do a couple of examples, but then I'm going to turn you loose to try to these yourselves. Okay, so, can you tell me any tips already you've learned with working these? Okay. Working downward will definitely help. What else? Okay.
Have a helpful person around.
Okay. Okay, I can't write that fast. Hold on.
Hard stuff.
Learn how to write that.
So, if you have... If you have several different trig functions in a problem, you should change it to what? Yes. That will definitely help you if you're stuck going to sine and cosine. It's always a good bet. Justice, why are we throwing things in the air?
No flying projectiles.
I was making sure I threw in the trash can. I'll pull it back and walk away.
He missed 3 times.
But he looks cool on the last one, didn't he?
Okay, so now you guys finish this one. If you have fractions that are being added or subtracted, what
should
you
do?
There you go. You should make common denominators. And given that most of those identities are fractions, you're going to make a lot of common denominators. This will make your algebra skills better as well. Okay. You all should be able to finish this one, too. If you have squared terms...
Give us mountain.
You have squared terms that are added or subtracted. Okay, so you see a problem that's got a cotangent squared in it and a cosecant squared in it. Addition or subtraction, what identity should you be looking at? Yes. So if you have square terms that are added or subtracted, check numbers 6, 7, and 8, because they certainly can help. Especially, I should also tack on there, especially if it's got a 1 involved, a 1 plus, or 1 minus something. If you've got 1's involved, know that 6, 7, and 8 all have 1's in them, so if you see a 1 in there, there's a good chance you might be looking at 6, 7, 8 as well. Okay. The others are going to come from our examples we're going to do here. So we'll add some more to this as we go. So let us try one here. Okay, how's about we have less extraneous conversations? Extraneous is a cool word. You're correct. But less important at the moment. Okay, this problem often looks intimidating. Why? Yeah, there are 4th powers in it. Like, okay, I don't have any identities that have 4th powers in it. I can use numbers 1 through 5 and put 4th power on them, but do I really want to change that to cosine to the 4th over sine to the 4th? That'd be pretty ugly. So there is an algebraic thing you should do here when you see big powers. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
So
we're going to add that to our list. If you have powers that are greater than 2, try factoring. You've got to get it broken down into something you can work with. Okay, folks, I am going to stop posting notes.
No.
if you do not start paying attention, because some of you are, most of you are not taking any notes anymore, and you're not paying any attention to me. This is a hard chapter. And if you are not, if you're going to sit there and talk all the time, I'm not going to post notes. I'm going to force you to take them. So I suggest the conversation cease. You need every bit of help you can get. Okay. Yeah, we're going to factor, but how do you factor fourth powers? I asked them this morning how you factor x to the fourth minus y to the fourth. Yeah, you do. Those are actually perfect squares. The fourth powers are also squares. It's a difference of squares. You can unfoil it. Matt just told me x squared plus y squared and x squared minus y squared. Yeah, they're conjugates. So in our case, though, it's going to be what?
Cosecant squared.
Plus. Well, it doesn't matter which order you do them in. Plus cosecant squared.
Yeah.
And then. Yes. Now, did that help us? Well, it should have helped us at least put what identities in play here. What should we probably start looking at now? We should be looking at 6, 7, 8, but particularly 8, because 8 is the only one that's got cotangents and cosecant squares in it. So, yeah, it's got to have something to do with 8, but we've got one with cotangent squared plus cosecant squared, and one with cotangent squared minus cosecant squared. There's no way we're going to get both of those out of number 8, but one of those is number 8. Yeah, because you would have to subtract, if you look at your identity, you would have to subtract cotangent squared to the other side. Cosecant squared minus cotangent squared would equal, actually I take that back, we need to go the other way, don't we? We need to go cotangent squared minus cosecant squared. How do I do that? Yeah. So therefore, cotangent squared minus cosecant squared is going to equal what here? It's going to equal a negative 1, because we'd have to bring the 1 over to the right-hand side to do that. So that means I can change which one of these. Yeah, the right-hand quantity just wiped out and became negative 1. So now you have negative 1 times cotangent, a quantity cotangent squared plus cosecant squared. Okay, now is when you should also start looking at the other side. The other side is only cosecant. Is there some way I can get this cotangent to become a cosecant squared? You could go to sines and cosines. Actually, it'll take you longer if you do on this one. When you're talking only still have squares here, number 8 is still in play. You can't make it become cotangent squared plus cosecant squared. You can't get this whole quantity. But if we're trying to equal something that's only a cosecant squared out there, can I find a way to take this lonely little cotangent squared and make it become a cosecant squared? But what does cotangent squared itself equal? If I want cotangent squared alone, I can subtract the 1 over and have cosecant squared minus 1. So now be careful. You're going to replace that. We're going to put in cosecant squared minus 1. But realize, did we change that plus cosecant squared? Mm-mm. So, how many cosecant squares do you now have? Now, when you add them up, you have 2 cosecant squares. Minus 1, and it's all times a negative 1. And I want it to be... If I distribute the negative 1, won't it equal the other side? Amazing! So, yes, I will get a negative 2 cosecant squared and a positive 1, and it would equal the right-hand side then. So, realize you might use the same identity more than once there. You just use it in a different way each time.
That was evil. That was hardcore.
Like, you and Betty
had some.
serious. You have to think
about it. No, I am not serious.
We have less problems than the last assignment,
and a couple of them were calculated problems, which I will talk to you about being Okay, that was one example I wanted you to see what to do with big powers. Okay, the other example I want you to see is one with some fairly major fraction action. Okay. This is a lovely little problem.
Not very little.
You're kind of correct on that one. The left side is not very little. What do you notice about the left side?
It's a fraction.
What trig function?
Well,
it's all cosine and sine, but notice you can factor that bottom one. Why do you notice you can factor the bottom one?
Because it's got
squared. Yeah. Isn't it just a quadratic equation? The bottom's just quadratic, so we will be able to factor the bottom one, or at least we hope we can factor the bottom one. The top one, what bugs you about the top? It's the trig function. You got a cosine squared and sine. In fact, that entire fraction is all sine except for the one little lonely cosine squared. So that cosine squared is kind of in our way. Also, consider the other side. What are you likely to do to the right-hand side since it contains a cosecant of x? You're probably going to change it to 1 over sine. So the right-hand side is probably going to become something that's all sine. And if the left-hand side is almost all sines except the cosine squared, we probably should try to do what? Change the cosine squared to something else. Hint, it's cosine squared!
That rearranged
number 6, that means I can change it to 1 minus sine squared. And then I'll keep the rest of my terms here. Do you wish to continue to work this side, or do you want to change the right-hand side? We're going to have to work on both sides here.
Continue on the same thing.
Continue on this side? Okay, what do you notice can happen in the numerator now?
You
cancel the... The ones are gone now. So goodbye ones. We got a 1 minus 1. Those babies are out of there. Okay, so now. Okay, I'm not following what you mean. You mean cancel the sine squares? Can you cancel when you have pluses and minuses between terms? Nope, you can't. What do you mean? Because the way I'm saying it, no. Can you take x plus 1 and 1 minus, or 3 minus x and cancel the x's?
No.
You cannot. You have to be able to cancel from every term if there's pluses and minuses. That's illegal. You can't do that. Because it's now all the same. We are going to factor here. Factoring is screaming at you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all signs now. That's the point.
Okay,
now, this is the part that tends to bug people. I'm actually going to do the bottom here first. You notice that the bottom is quadratic, but what do you not like about it? Yeah, the sine squared is in the back. Oh, no. Can you factor? You could. I actually want you to learn how to factor with it in the back. It will not kill you. Okay.
Yeah, you got about 50 seconds.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll factor this and we'll switch here. Sine squared. Okay, I know it's got to be a sine and a sine. So what? It goes in the back.
Oh, you just put it in the
back. You just put it in the back. What are the factors of 3?
3 and 1.
3 and 1. Okay, where do I need my pluses and minuses?
After the 3, minus after the 1.
Plus after the second.
Because you want to end up with a positive 2.
Or before the second.
So we need the 3 to end up positive.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's going to be a positive 3. Minus 1 will make a positive 2. Okay, and so we'll stop here and we'll come